But it was just about 3 months ago, the Orioles made a new hire for a brand new general manager tasked with turning around a 115-loss club. His name is Mike Elias, and he shot up through the baseball ranks, starting as a scout and then the number two with the powerful Houston Astros, and now right here in Baltimore. And Mike Elias joins us right now on the Brett Hollander Show. Mike, thank you so much for coming on.
Hi, Brett. Thanks for having me.
Well, we do appreciate it. And first, you know, it sounds like a simple question, but you've only been in town for 3.5 months or so. You have to learn hundreds of players, all the departments of the organization. You've made a bunch of hires. How are you getting acclimated?
It's a lot. You know, when you switch organizations, this is my third time going from one organization to another. It's always overwhelming, just learning the players, the staff members, the facilities, how the business side of the organization is structured. It's a lot, and especially when you come in to the general manager's chair, it's quite a bit to take in all at once. But it's been fun. It's very invigorating, and we've been working every day since mid-November to get prepared for the season and beyond.
I've been called a homer before in my life, Mike. It's not the worst insult I've ever been given, but I look at what you inherited, and yes, it is a team that lost a lot of games last year. There's no getting around it. But some players that have some ability did make it to the big leagues. Tanner Scott, to me, this is a guy who could be a legitimate back-end arm. We saw some flashes from Cedric Mullins and DJ Stewart and a handful of other younger players. Three Orioles prospects were named to two different top 100 publication lists yesterday. A few more probably could have been on that list. Did you inherit something that is starting completely back at square one, or am I just naive?
No, the part of the attraction of our situation is we have very good players in the system, and not just at the minor league level, but on the major league level, like you mentioned. And these are young players. These are players that I think are going to be part of the next great Orioles team. And part of our task this year and our new manager, Brandon Hyde, is to develop the talent that we have at the big league level, while we're also adding talent to the pipeline and the minor leagues via trade, the draft, international signing. So just on all fronts, we're going to be looking to elevate the aggregate talent base in this organization. And a big part of that is continuing to develop the very quality players that we have here.
We're talking to Orioles' new general manager, Mike Elias. It has been a bizarre free agent market, Mike, as I'm sure you know, even though the Orioles have not really been involved. And it's not even about the Harpers and the Machados that are still out there, but that next group is all but a few guys are still looking for work right now. Could you see the Orioles at some point dipping into that market, even though it probably doesn't follow the exact pathway you've set forth? But if there's value somewhere there, could you see the Orioles jumping in?
We're certainly monitoring things very carefully and trying to be shrewd. One thing that we do need to be mindful of is we want to, as I said, we're trying to develop a lot of young players that are here. And the last thing that we want to do is block a talented young player that we have under control for a long period of time and cost him some opportunity to grow and continue to collect at-bats or innings at the major league level. So we've got to balance that with opportunities to kind of buttress and strengthen our roster with some supplemental ads, but we will certainly be keeping an eye on the free agent market into spring training.
Now, a lot of people look at you because I think your age and also your history and some of the hires you've already made, and you're going to update analytics for the Baltimore Orioles and bring the Orioles into the 21st century. I don't really know, and I've had this debate a lot over the years, how fans view some of these new numbers. I am not an expert. I admit I'm not an expert. I also know they're important, and I don't have to understand every metric that's thrown out there to know that experts can look at it and analyze it correctly and help it impact a ball club for the better. But I do believe, to some level, it's confusing to fans and maybe even a turnoff. Is it as drastic as some people make it out to be, that you are essentially, you and your predecessors, are reinventing the wheel over the last 15 or 20 years?
Well, there's a lot changing in the sport, and it's the proliferation of this data across the internet, just the ease with which we can get players' stats. And then now there's data derived from technology, these fixed radar devices at the stadiums, these cameras, these bat sensors that we have. There's just all kinds of stuff. We're all trying to make sense of it. I'm a scout. That's my background, first and foremost. I was an area scout, drove around, signed players for the draft, and I understand the importance of that part of the business, and it's never going away. But what we look to do and what we have done in Houston and St. Louis, the group that I've been a part of, is try to synthesize all that information so that there's just kind of one answer spitting out at us when we're sitting there trying to make decisions. And like you said, you're not overwhelmed by all this data that you don't quite understand. So we do a lot of work to put it into a funnel that gives us a very clear idea of a player's value.
Mike Elias, new Orioles general manager, is with us. FanFest coming up on Saturday from the Convention Center. The only big league player I want to ask you about, Mike, is Chris Davis, for all the obvious reasons. Highest paid athlete in the history of the Orioles, in the history of Baltimore sports. It's some kind of career when you look at the ups and downs of it. Is there anything that you have been looking at or you have intimated to Chris and the coaching staff in your brief period with the club that you could say, here is something, Chris, or Chris, let's look at this?
Well, he's excited for the fresh start, to have the 2018 season behind him, to have some new coaches, some new people around him. I know he's excited about that. We're going to give him every opportunity and every tool to get back to the form that we know he can be in. We are looking into things in terms of his approach at the plate that might be able to help him. But he's on a really good program. He's doing a lot of good work. I know he's preparing well for this season. I think he's putting himself in a position to bounce back. But certainly as we get going and we get plugged in with the analytical tools that we're building here, we'll be able to help all the players on the roster, you know, combat what the pitchers are going to do to them.
Mike, I imagine because you are an old scout, even though you're still a young guy, I think we're about the same age, and also you are a guy who ran drafts before, that the appeal of having the first overall pick must have been one of the things that said maybe Baltimore's a really good landing spot for me. It's not the pick you want to have too often if you're going to be successful, but you have it right now. At what point does that pick, which could set the trajectory of the franchise in some ways in the near and long-term future in its right path and course, how much of your time is looking at this draft? It's not just the first pick. It's the first pick basically in every round. How much of your time is going to be spent in the coming months on that?
A great deal of my time, probably more than normal for a general manager, for the reasons that you listed. And especially as spring training ends and we get into April and May and the draft coming in June, I expect to be spending most of my time concentrating on the draft. But as you mentioned, the number one pick is a big opportunity. It's tricky in baseball, and you know, when you take out the years where there was sort of a no-brainer generational Ken Griffey, Bryce Harper pick, the returns on the number one pick versus the number two or three pick, it's not that dramatic when you take out those years. So it can be tough, but we have a lot of experience. I have a lot of experience, kind of an uncommon level of experience with these high draft picks. We had a bunch of them in Houston, and they didn't go perfectly, but we did very, very well. We took two MVP caliber players and a third guy who's a rookie who's going to be an MVP caliber player. And the good news, I think, for the Orioles and for me right now is that the Orioles are going to benefit from all that experience, even the bad experience that we had. We're ready, and I like the choices that we have on hand, so we'll just see what happens.
Last one, Mike. You are from the area. You're from Northern Virginia, not too far away from Camden Yards growing up. How much of that factored into the overall appeal of the job in Baltimore?
It factored in a lot. It's cool for a number of reasons, but I know what this franchise is capable of. I know what the city looks like. I know that this can be one of the best baseball towns in America and one of the best franchises for players to come play in America. You know, Mike Mussina just got elected to the Hall of Fame the other day, and I vividly remember watching him pitch on the 93 team growing up, and just that whole era of Orioles baseball. So it was a big attraction for me, and then, you know, being close to family and at home didn't hurt either, but I just know what this market and this franchise is capable of because I've seen it firsthand.
Mike Elias, the Orioles' new GM. We have FanFest coming up on Saturday from the Convention Center downtown. Pitchers and catchers report in just a few weeks in Sarasota, Florida. Doesn't that sound nice? Mike, welcome to town. We appreciate it. I hope we can get you on again.
Thanks. Anytime. Appreciate it, guys.